So guys, my name is Sharat Chandra. So I am the co-founder and CTO of Crayonic Labs. So I've been in the gaming industry for close to around 8 years or so. I've been in through testing, through development cycle, through a design cycle as well. Been in the industry and trying to push Unity. So I'm one of the guys who's been using Unity since 2.3, and which is a long time. And I've seen evolution of things happen. So which brings me to my talk today, which is basically extending realities. It's the way how we can transform the future. Right? How many guys of you have experienced virtual reality? Sweet. So that's a good crowd. So what is virtual reality? Virtual reality is basically getting a person into the shoes of an already pre-rendered or a real-time rendering environment that a person is placed into. So he has the flexibility of moving left, right, not moving left and right. I could say looking left and right and doing all the things that you would do normally, right? So there are different ways of doing this. So this is actually the third boot of virtual reality that has been there through the years. The first one obviously came out with huge machines in which you have to put your head inside, and you get to see a lot of graphics in front of you. Along with that, what they had also was smells. So it was called the smellorama. So people used to get the scent of different things that were there around. So that gave a different kind of a feeling for people altogether. So that, when moved aside, that was way in the past compared to what they had the second cycle, which was using with smaller gaming hardware. They tried to get out a virtual reality system which was very bulky, and not many people were interested in purchasing these equipments. That's when, you know, technology became much better, transistors got much smaller, things got compact, and when we came to the point in which we have the current setup. So the current setup is basically a very nice mixture of accelerometers and gyroscopes put together inside the HMD that you're wearing. So it could be a mobile phone, or it could be a standalone HMD that has these factors in place and give out these values so that you can basically do a lot of alteration. So using virtual reality is one of the key factors in the XR area right now. We've used it for quite a number of things. I'll be talking about a couple of industry use cases that we've used VR, AR and MR in the next few slides, right? So augmented reality. Again, augmented reality is something that you would basically augment 3D onto an already existing area. So let's say I want to have a 3D image come up here. So I would use an app or a HMD like the HoloLens, and you would have different 3D objects pop up and you could interact with them. So these are different factors at play. So we've got a lot of players in the augmented reality area. Vuforia is one of these guys. So they've been in the industry for quite some time and have been providing a lot of solutions. You have marker-based augmented reality solutions, then you have marker-less augmented reality solutions, then you have 3D objects. So they can scan 3D objects and basically figure out that, yeah, this is something that needs to be augmented on top of the left side, on the right side, right? So these are the older techniques. Right now, we've got a couple of new kits in the market which are actually bringing out a lot more of augmented content, okay? So a couple of these are the Google Tango. Have you guys heard of that? So the Google Tango gives you, again, positional tracking within a space. So let's say I start the application over here, and I've already loaded a 3D content, like let's say a room that faces out this big. I can start moving from here, and the visual in our augmented app is basically going to make you go through that 3D space, right? So again, this is something that wasn't viable too much because, see, Google Tango is a very specified segment of phones that is to come out. It's not yet out in the market. Like you have one or two mobile phones that basically support Google Tango. Tango works on a new technology in which you have depth sensors. So depth sensing is happening at almost all point of time and figuring out where you are in that 3D space. All right, so it's 3D positional tracking with actual data coming from 3D depth sensing. Now, recently we had two new players in the market. I mean, not new players, I would say. Two new kits in the market. One is from Apple, which is the AR kit. So the AR kit basically is another algorithm that they've written. So there's a lot of image-based processing that happens over here. Every single frame is checked to see if, you know, if there is a surface. And once the surface is there, it creates a point cloud. A point cloud is created, and when enough of point clouds are there, it creates a small area, which basically is an interactable space. Now, this is a plane that is placed around all these places where you have, what do you call, elevated and flat angles, all right? So, this is one way in which you can utilize. So, I'll show you guys a small demonstration of ARKit using one of the demonstrations that we had recently placed out for the Karnataka Tourism Board, right? So that's about augmented reality. Then comes mixed reality. Mixed reality is something, so a lot of people keep talking about mixed reality and I think HoloLens is something that first comes into your mind. But I would say HoloLens is more of a augmented solution rather than it being a mixed solution. So mixed reality solutions usually come with a lot of things together. So there are perception things that are there, and then there are interaction based things that are there. So perception things again, you know, are with 3D displays that you can have. You can have holograms that are there. You can also have head mounted displays. As I told you guys, you have a HMD put onto you, and then you have experience that comes out of that. So these all come under the bandwagon of immersive technology. So it could be auditory things like 3D audio that you're placed into, and then there's surround sound, there are tactile things, which is kind of like actuators. You have haptic devices that you can use, which basically give you the motion, and you can have vibration and things like that, that you could have interactions based out of, right? And then there are smaller things like the interaction systems. You have gesture recognition systems. Have you guys heard of the Leap Motion? So the Leap Motion is a small device that was launched a couple of years back. But right now, with the advent of virtual reality, mixing that with VR headsets is something that's really cool. So you have your headset on, you have the Leap Motion right in front of you. That captures your hands, and you have an interaction engine now. So you can basically interact with the things. Even though you have controllers in VR, with the HTC Vive and the Oculus, I think you guys have seen the controllers that come with it. It's not fluidic. Like, it's, again, you know, very bottled down to what it would do. Like, let's say you have a fist close motion and you have a fist open motion, you would basically do animations based on that, open close, whereas with things like the Leap Motion in place, you actually have your complete fingers moving around, fluid motions, you could do a lot more things, okay? Moving on, so Crayonic and how we've used XR at the studio. So we've been in operation for the past 3 years. We've pushed into quite a few areas. The first being an obvious choice, which is the case study that we had, which was for architecture. So architecture was something that we initially started off with. We built a couple of close to around 11 projects, and we figured out that, hey, there are a couple of things, you know, that are common in these projects. Why don't we get all these things together and build a product out of it? So it took us time to figure out what are the right stitching solutions to keep all this together. We started building tools inside Unity so that, let's say, a repetitive process, if you have to do one thing again and again and again, you would take a lot of time to do it, because you're basically doing the same process 3, 4, 5 times, okay? So we built smaller tools inside Unity that gives equips our artists and level designers to build things much faster and being more organized, right? So this brought us to getting out a project, a product called Space View. Space View basically gives us the solution of showcasing architectural walkthroughs and architectural solutions, basically using virtual reality and augmented reality. So what we have as a future endeavor with Space View is the fact that you can add in CAD files or DWG files, anything that is related to the architecture industry. We're trying to get these things culminated together so that it would work just out of the box. Instead of a person who works at an architectural studio coming to us again and again, we would license this product out to them so that they can build n number of exe files by themselves, right? So architecture was one case study that we felt that was very compelling altogether. But again, we didn't feel the pain points of the industry was being resolved very nicely, because a lot of people want the graphics to look like V-Ray. And that's not possible with real-time rendering. With real-time rendering, you need a lot of processing power. So if you want that, it should be either on a PC hardware, which people are not reluctant to have because the hardware itself is costly. So on mobile phones, it's not possible for you to get almost a lifelike structure for things. So that's why we thought, let's shift gears a bit. And then we moved into the next case study, which is basically engineering. So for engineering, we had a different kind of a solution. So we had almost reached the end of the product cycle for architecture. That's when a couple of people came up to us and asked us, hey, see, we have these problems in the engineering field. So one of our clients, they wanted us to create something which is a new marketing tool altogether. So they had an experience zone in which they wanted to talk to their customers about the products that they have worked on. So they worked in the aerospace industry. So what we did for them was really cool. So we built them a complete virtual hangar, and inside that hangar there's a huge plane, and on the left hand side is a menu system which contains basically the different products that they worked on the aircraft. So they select that, everything blacks out, and only that product comes in front of them, explodes, and shows them which product they worked on. So this was a new kind of solution. Once they showed it out, so this was at an expo. They had a lot of people come in from Airbus, from Boeing. All these guys came in and saw this. They were really impressed, and they so again, it came to a factor in which they were asking us, how can we make this better? All right, that's when we told them, see, this is as of now a marketing solution. What we plan on doing is trying to bring it for training purposes. So that's when we started moving towards training simulators and things like that, in which people could experience the training before actually going on the field. So they have these experiences that are kept offline in VR, in which they would do, like, let's say a ground control check. So they would do a pre-flight check on aircraft right before doing the in-flight checks. Right? So the whole pre-flight check is done in VR. They would understand that, and then they would go to a real aircraft and do the rest of their work. This considerably saved, let's say, the company that we've dealt with almost $1 million. So they didn't need to actually keep that aircraft over there for training. Rather, they had that put into the process of getting it, getting people, passengers from places to from one place to the other. So engineering went on in another field altogether, and in which we would provide simulating solutions like fluid simulations, things like that, and showcase that. So what we would do is we would get data from our clients, and we would plug the data inside Unity. So basically they already have the raw data that for simulation, and we are trying and pushing these raw data properties onto our existing products that we have in Unity, right? So again, it's a very painstaking process, because most engineering clients use a varied sizes of products, and it's very different altogether. So we're still trying to figure out which is the best kind of a way in which we could actually have simulation systems working for engineering. It's a big question mark for us also, to see how we can actually move this to the next level. And then we come on to the next case study, which is actually one which was really fun: sports. So in sports, we had a small idea in which we wanted to build a small cricketing experience. So we built something called the Super Over, and we basically built a small cricketing experience within just 5 days. We did a little bit of play testing with some real cricketers. They came in, they gave us a couple of pointers, how to make your delivery balls much better and things like that. So we fine-tuned that, tweaked it, we put it in a box. During the IPL season, we tried to open that box again, but yeah, the key was locked. But we had something called KPL, which is Karnataka Premier League, and they were very receptive of our solution. So at that point of time, what they did was they found us a sponsor for this, and this did a round in three different cities altogether: in Bangalore, in Mysore, and in Hubli. And what we did was we connected analytics and we connected heat maps to this to get the best out of it. So we got this data to back out our findings as well in on the field, how it would work out. So that's how we used VR. How we used AR was a really cool thing altogether as well. So you guys have heard of loyalty cards, right? So loyalty cards from different clubs and things like that. So what we did was we built our AR content on top of loyalty cards. So the card would be your marker, which would read on an app that we've built, and you could scroll through the whole team's statistics and check out all their data real time. So this was actually connected to CrickBuzz to get the data from there. So we were streaming that data up and down without having any problems. Then again, after all this, we still do have a couple of limitations, okay? The limitations being that the technology is, it's there, but it's not the fact, it's not there to the fact that, you know, a person can be completely immersed altogether. As I told you, it's immersive technology that needs to be built over the future. So combining different products and putting them together is how we can actually let go of the little limitations that we have. I think the biggest problem that we face is having the right system to deal with it, because even when we started off with, we started off with a 960 graphics card for the HTC Vive, which didn't serve its purpose at all. We switched over to the 1060 and boom, we have an amazing performance, especially tended towards VR by itself. So limitations are there as of now, which might slow you down, but I would say that, you know, this is, that's the area which could drive you to building your product to a much better level altogether. So I shall show you guys a small demo that we did for augmented reality. So this was a small project that, and this is a small bit of that project, which took us close to around 3 days to build out. Just give me a minute.
AR kit. So, have you guys seen the AR kit in action before? Yes. Okay. So, as I was telling you guys, see, as I'm moving around, can you see the point cloud that's being performed? So, there's a point cloud that comes, and then there's this plane that is being generated across it. So, you have an area so that this you can have interactions on it. So, how we built it is, as soon as we have an area placed out, you tap on it, and it brings out the AR content. Okay. That is basically this lion that's over here. The tiger that's over here. So you click on start, the experience starts, you get it out, and then the tiger comes in front. You have different operations and up and down. Right? So the thing with the AR kit and the AR core from Google is the fact that for the first time you actually have light reactive environments built. Lighting of that specific object is basically very static.
Augmented reality systems that talk. Do you guys have any questions?